Well, I'll go ahead and start because now it's getting awkward. I'm just talking, so let's go ahead and start. And folks will come in. They'll miss a minute of like boring intros. But no, so I'm Bermon. That is my branding, I guess. What do you want to call it? I am from the glorious city of Charlotte, North Carolina. I've been there about 7 years. Born and raised in Alabama on a farm. I have six siblings. I have a wife and a kid. Kids hanging out there. Taking notes, or I guess doodling. She likes to doodle, so she's going to doodle while I talk and hopefully not fall asleep. It'll be great. Yeah, like the last time. So she was sleepy that day. And my voice is nice and soothing, I've been told. No, so you've all seen the Sass logo, right? Like if you worked with Sass. I designed it. Isn't that awesome? It is for me. Yeah. No, so I had a, anybody ever meet Michael Parenteau? I used to work for Cognitech here in Raleigh, or I guess in Durham. Awesome guy, fantastic illustrator, artist. He's like a jolly black-bearded Saint Nick, like really nice, really kind, a lot of fun to hang out with. So, two or three years ago now, they put out an open call to see who wanted to contribute to redesigning the Sass brand. So I raised my hand. So I got to work with Mike, who's phenomenal, and Gina Bolton, who's great from Salesforce, doing really great stuff. Got to work with rebranding the whole site, got to design the logo. Totally don't do that very much, especially script type logos, not my thing. The earlier iterations are up on Dribbble. They look horrible because I've never done script text before. So yeah, that's what it turned out as. So Sass logo. In Charlotte, I organize a handful of local events, one for front end, one for UX, and the now dead Blend conference that I used to put on. It has seen its last conference, so that's over. And then I work for Cardinal Solutions. We're based out of Cincinnati. We have an office here like between Raleigh and Durham. I'm not sure which one they actually claim. I think the address is technically Raleigh. But it's like right smack dab in the middle of both cities. So you can go to either. And then I manage UX practice. So in anything UX, design, front end, falls under our practice, and we're hiring. So if you do design, or you do front end, or you do UX stuff, you can totally chat with me, and we can see what you'd like to do. And you can find me online at Bermon Painter. That's Twitter, Skype, Gmail, whatever. If you have any Sass questions, you can totally just Skype me, or email me, or hit me up on Twitter, and we can chat about it. So today, we're gonna talk about modular Sass. And I'm gonna share a handful of thoughts around Sass in general, and talk about ways that we can create modular Sass code. And then I'll go in and show you some examples from a past project that we had done so you can see some real life stuff. Now, the whole point of this is to take the typical mindset that we've had doing front-end development, make a few slight adjustments. Now, out of curiosity, who's been doing front-end for more than 10 years? Okay, a few folks back in the good old days of FTP before preprocessors, and you just created a CSS file and wrote what little was supported back then and FTP'd it up to a server somewhere and it just magically worked. You did it all in production all the time, basically. And it's changed a little bit. Who's been doing it for less than 5? Okay, less than 2? Like less than 1, like just getting started. Okay, cool. So it's changed a lot, and there's a lot of things that you kind of have to do when you're getting things set. I was just talking to the folks at the GDI booth earlier about like how it's not as easy because there are a bunch of different things that you have to kind of know about tangentially. Like you have to know version control, and you have to know a little bit about Node, and package managers, and all these other things just so you can get some project set up, which is kind of ridiculous, but that's kind of the way it's gone. The whole purpose of what we're trying to do and kind of why the industry has gone the way that it has is that we're trying to build this more modular mindset where we're thinking of things into as smaller components. So in Sass, we're taking these smaller objects, trying to make them dry and responsive, and importantly, make them also accessible. This is a quote that I like from Stephen Hay. Brad Frost also talks about this a good bit, is, 10 years ago, a designer would get a Photoshop comp and give that over to the front-end folks or the developers, and they would kind of go from the top left and code that up into a design, right? So that they would do that on a page-to-page basis and get whatever system that they were creating. So the point now, or the focus now, is that we're trying to think of things in much smaller chunks. So here's this piece of code that does this thing that I can reuse in a number of areas. And then we use a bunch of those smaller pieces to build pages. So that's the overall idea of the thought of where things are going. Now, over the past number of years, there have been a handful of ideas or concepts around how we write our front-end code. These are three of probably the more popular. I kind of dig all of them to a certain degree. So one thing to keep in mind is that you don't have to just choose one. So let's talk through those real quick and kind of contrast and compare what they are and how they work. So the first one came about from Nicole Sullivan. She is a phenomenal front-end developer, does a lot of great work, did some great work for Facebook, has done some amazing stuff around these concepts. So she kind of coined the term of OOCSS, which stands for Object-Oriented CSS. Now, it's a methodology where you're trying to write these reusable pieces of CSS that's fast and scalable, hopefully maintainable. So you're thinking of your CSS as objects, basically. So objects, in this case, are basically HTML. So you have these HTML objects, and you're styling them and doing what you need to do with CSS. Now, one of the concepts that she has is this level of abstraction, where you're abstracting structure from look and feel, right? So your structural CSS that lays it out like it should be from the CSS that makes it look like what it's supposed to look like. So things like positioning or presentational styles, that would be like background colors, border colors, imagery, background images, that they give something a look and feel. The second concept is you're separating your container from the content, which I think is a pretty important principle. So any object that you create, right, any HTML object that you create should be able to be placed in another container and still look and function like it was intended originally. So that's what she's trying to do. Now, this is a pretty common example, right? This is an accordion. An accordion typically has some type of title and then some type of control, and then that title and control have some relation to the content, right? Like the accordion pane, if you want to call it that. So you click the plus sign or click the arrows, or you click on the title, and it expands and contracts the pane, right? The accordion pane. Now, if I was writing this in object-oriented CSS, it might look something kind of like that, right? So I'm calling my accordion an accordion, right? That totally makes sense. We're going to call it that. And then the accordion has a title and it has a content pane. Content goes in there. And then I might have some type of action somewhere. Now, this is kind of where we're separating look and feel, right? So we have the overall structural CSS that makes our accordion lay out like it should. And then we have a couple of the classes that are kind of weird. We have box border and we have separator border, which gives us the borders, the border on the box that you really can't see on this screen, but then the separating border is there. So it's specific to this implementation, and the only thing that they do is they add borders. Now, I might want to add borders on things that aren't just an accordion, and that's going to set up that way. So that's kind of what we have. Now, for writing CSS for that, you might end up with something kind of similar. So we're just using basic descendant selectors to set up our accordion, and then the title and the content in relation to the accordion, and then we have our two border classes that are kind of sitting by themselves at the root level, if you want to call it that, in our CSS, that we can reuse anywhere, and we know that one of them is going to give a border around any type of element, and the other is going to add kind of a bottom border, so we have some separator. The next concept, who is my personal favorite, from Jonathan Snook, the friendly Canadian, used to work at Shopify. Oh no, did it crash? It totally did something weird. There we go. Yeah, so Jonathan Snook. Jonathan Snook used to work for Yahoo, worked for Shopify, and had some really great concepts around front-end development. So his goal behind this concept of SMACS, which is Scalable Modular Architecture for CSS, is to identify repeating patterns. Microsoft. Silly Microsoft. Let's try that again. Okay, so he's trying to identify those patterns and code those into these flexible, reusable modules that you can use over and over again. So if like front end is your thing and you really enjoy it, you should totally read that book. It is great, it's short. You can read it in a weekend or the drive back home, but not while driving. Hopefully somebody else is driving for you. He has most of it online for free. There are some Sass bits that are kind of behind the purchase. So it's great. He also does a workshop around this, totally worthwhile. I believe you can buy some of that online, it's recorded. So great read. Now, this is the way that he kind of separates things out. So he has this idea of base level CSS. So this is where all of the base styles live. Any resets, element defaults, so like your H1s, your H6s, your paragraphs, your lists, they all live in our base. Our default font sizes, all that good stuff. And this directory is primarily full of your base level elements. Anything that's not a class or an ID or an attribute, just your base elements. They live there. The next one is layout. So in this directory, you would typically try and specify all the types of layout containers that might exist, like headers, footers, content, sidebars. The layout elements don't really have any styles applied to them. They only divide the websites into sections, right? So like grid systems and things like that would live in your layout. Let's see, we also have modules. Now, the bulk of your CSS is probably going to go in the module directory, right? That's where all the magic happens. All the really nifty things that you do would be here in modules or in submodules. Now, every module should be independent of its context. So I should be able to take a module and put it anywhere inside of the application or website that I'm creating, and it should work within whatever layout or container I put it in, right? That's the goal. And then one thing that he does that I really, really like is the separation of states. So if you're building these engaging websites or applications, you're going to have a state. Things are going to be open or closed or visible or invisible. So he uses a states directive to place these there, and it's great. The final one is this concept of theme. So it's similar to object-oriented CSS where you're separating structure from look and feel. He does the same thing here, and I really like that. This, I believe, anybody use Bootstrap? You love Bootstrap? A lot? I kind of hate it. It's good, like it's a really good framework, but it's so painful sometimes to try and theme and have Bootstrap sites not look like Bootstrap. This kind of, they're trying to move this direction, right? But this is kind of the problem, where it would be so nice to just have structural CSS that has no theme things applied. So I can just go through and create a theme file and just style things. I have an overwrite things everywhere. That would be so amazing. So that's kind of where this concept comes from, right? Because we want to be able to create these modules. Like an accordion's an accordion. The HTML structure and the JavaScript and the structural CSS doesn't really change from site to site, but the way it looks might change a little bit. So it's nice to be able to have that live on a per site basis or have like a Bootstrap theme. And I can make it look like Bootstrap, or I can do something totally different. That's the goal. So the goal then is to take something like the accordion, and we break those components down into kind of their smallest dependency, and to try and never mimic the overall, like we don't want to do, write CSS, it looks like we're writing HTML in CSS. It's kind of weird. So if I was going to write HTML for that, I might do something kind of like this. So again, I'm going to create an accordion class because it's kind of the parent. I'm going to namespace it accordion, and then I might have an accordion title, an accordion content, and then there's really only a couple states or a state that I'm going to toggle. The accordion is either active or inactive. So if the title is active, my plus sign is going to change to a minus sign or vice versa. And I might do a different visual for the title. And then if my content container is active, it's going to appear. If it's inactive, it's going to shut, right? So he's managing state that way, which I think is great. Now, if I'm writing CSS, it's going to look pretty similar to the object oriented CSS version, right? Now, in this case, you'll notice that I'm just doing accordion title, accordion content. I'm not doing any descendant selectors, so everything's at the root level for the most part, which is pretty good. John Long, here in Raleigh, that works at User Voice, he really pushes this a lot, like on the Sass way, which is a fantastic Sass blog that has lots of examples and great stuff. I've been like trying to wrap my brain around feeling comfortable just doing everything at the root level and not doing any nested selectors at all. Once you get used to it, it's nice because then you hardly ever have to deal with specificity, which is great. And then the third one. So this is the team at Yandex. They created this concept called BIM. Now BIM stands for block, element, and modifier. Now blocks are top level abstractions of a new component. They're basically the parent of the parent of what we're creating. And we'll show you an example in a second. The element or any child items or child elements that can be placed inside the block. And then we have a modifier. So modifiers manipulate the block so that we can theme or style a particular component or do something completely unrelated to the core CSS for the module itself. So again, we have the accordion. Visually, it doesn't change at all. But if we're writing the HTML for that, we might end up with something like this. So we have our block, which we've called accordion, which is our parent level class. We have accordion title and accordion content. Now, if you write CSS a lot, that might look a little bit weird. It has two underscores. Now, in BIM, two underscores is what denotes an element level element, which is kind of weird. That's the element, right? So that's the child of the block. So that's how it looks. I still don't like it too much, but it's useful. And I'll explain why in a second. And then we have our state, or our modifier, right? So modifiers in BIM are denoted with two hyphens. And again, it kind of looks weird because you're mixing underscores and hyphens, and you can get super crazy on how you're modifying things. But this is the benefit. Like, if you're the sole developer on a project, like this is just your portfolio site, you can totally use it. It's not a big deal. You can use it at whatever level you feel like using it. But if you're working on a team of 50, 60, 100 front-end developers, it is super useful. I'm not one on conformity, but in this case, this is probably where I'm okay with conforming, right? Conforming to standards and kind of doing everything the same, because that means you're writing the same type of CSS. Now, what that allows me to do is, if I go in and look at somebody else's code, I know what a block level class is versus a modifier versus an element, and I can see where they're kind of intertwined or integrated, right? So it's easier to read. It's just kind of weird if you're just now adjusting to looking at a bunch of underscores and double hyphens. So if I'm writing my CSS, it might look something kind of like that. Now again, I'm keeping things at a root level, so I don't have to worry about specificity as much in the future, which is pretty nice. So the whole idea, I think, is like we have all of these methodologies and ideas, and these aren't the only three. There's a handful out there that constantly change. And if you write that, it's totally for grins, because I don't know, you just like smush them all together, you get something weird. So I don't know, I kind of like using concepts from all of them, where it makes sense, or I guess depending on what side of the bed I woke up that day, because it totally depends, right? I mean, write CSS and enjoy writing it, but tinker with stuff and see how you like it. Now, when I'm writing modules, these are my own personal requirements, what my expectations are for myself and for our team on how we do things. And some of them kind of take the three concepts we just discussed and like squish them all together into something that makes sense for what we do. So one is any module we create should be nested, right? So this concept of it being able to live on its own, live outside of context or any other context without totally exploding. It should work wherever I stick it. Two, I should be able to take a module and another module and kind of squish them together, and they should still work, right? So I should be able to combine things together to create bigger, badder, better modules in some way. Three, anybody mess with Flexbox at all? Do you love it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was like a half-hearted, yeah, kind of. I'm in the same boat. Like I totally dig the concept. I think it's glorious, and when it works, it's great. But it's a little more to wrap your head around, and I'm a little bit slow from Alabama. But no, so it's a little more to wrap your head around. It's not as easy as floats, but it's supposed to be easier than floats. But I dig it. If you haven't messed with Flexbox, it really is great, because it gets really smart, and it automates some of those layout annoyances that exist sometimes. But not every browser supports Flexbox yet, so we still have to use floats, which means that we still have to clearfix. So clearfix basically help with floating layout issues. If you don't know what that means, talk to me after and we can chat. But it's super simple. Four, responsive is a thing, so all of our modules need to be independently flexible. They should ebb and flow with the web, because that's the point of the web. It kind of moves a little bit. We have more device sizes that I can care to keep up with now, so I just don't care. So just make it flow a bit, and it should work out fine. And then fifth is kind of the concept from SMAX and OSCSS, which is the separating our structure from our theme. So from a module level, we actually have two versions of each module. One is the structure, and the other one is the specific skin for whatever site or application that we're working on. And last but not least is accessibility, right? Any module that we create, anything we put on the web, should be accessible. Not just for folks that have disabilities, but that should just be the general rule of thumb. Anything we create should be accessible. Okay, so this is this is how I write my CSS. And it's similar to some of the other stuff. So I still have an accordion as my parent, or my block, if you want to call it that. And then everything's namespace, so I have my title and my content, which is totally fine. I haven't quite sold myself enough on BIM. We have some developers that absolutely love it. It's just super weird for me still, which is probably ridiculous, but it is. I'm trying to make myself use it a bit more. And then instead of using classes to manage state, which kind of feels icky, because it's more, those types of classes are tied to JavaScript more they are look and feel. So I prefer to use data attributes in HTML5 to manage my state. So in this case, I have a state for the title and a state for the content, and they're open or closed. You can call it active and active, whatever you wanted to call it. That's a much better hook for JavaScript. So in my case, when I'm looking at my HTML and I see a data attribute, I know there's probably some JavaScript that's tying into that somewhere. Anybody use Angular at all? Yeah, like data attributes everywhere. They use that all over the place, which is great to a degree, I think. For running my CSS, might have something kind of like this. Data state, I'm just using an attribute selector for my CSS for open and closed, and that works pretty well. Now, let's turn that into Sass. Now, if I'm using Sass, now this is a Sassy syntax. I really kind of like the Sass syntax, which means like there's no semicolons and curly braces, which is easier to read for me, but it's kind of weird for some people. So in this case, this is a Sassy syntax. It looks like CSS. It's just nested. Now, what you'll see there is we have an accordion, but I'm not doing accordion title and accordion content. I'm using an ampersand. Now, the ampersand is something they call a reference selector or a parent selector. And what that's doing is it's looking at the nearest parent, and it's going to spit that into the ampersand. So when I turn that into CSS, I'm really going to get something like that. So it's going to take those nested elements and still spit those out at a root level, but use the correct namespacing. So that's a great way to structure your CSS or your Sass to get good stuff. Now, in the previous example, we had just like the basic accordion, right? It looks something like that. Now, the challenge with that is if I'm using a screen reader, the screen reader is going to have any idea what's going on. It's not going to tab very well into the title or to the content. There's no relation really between the two. It's not going to know what's enabled and what's disabled. So we need to add a few niceties to make that work pretty well. So in HTML5, the spec is called ARIA, A-R-I-A. And it has so many nice things that you can use to make your HTML so much more accessible. One thing that you'll see is on our accordion, we've given it an attribute called role. So role defines the type of module this is for a screen reader. In this case, accordions are basically like tabs, right? So you click on a tab and it shows content, you click on another tab, it hides the other content, and you see the content specific to the tab. Accordions function the exact same way, they're just displayed differently visually. So there's a role specific to ARIA called tablist that allows us to define this as an ARIA module that functions like tabs. So you'll see that we have three roles specific to this. So we have our parent role, which is our tab list. On our title, we have a role called tab. That means this is the tab. This is the thing we click on and interact with to show content somewhere. And then for the panel, we have a role called tab panel. So that gives the relationship between the tab itself and the tab panel. There are a few of the things that we're doing. We've added an ID on each of these. So that we can use ARIA controls and ARIA labeled by. So we know that the tab controls panel 1. So you do that for tab 1, tab 2, panel 1, panel 2. So they're related together. You do the converse of that in your panel. So you're saying that this panel is labeled by tab 1. So it kind of is like a little bit redundant, but links the two together so the content correlates. Instead of using data attributes, there are attributes in ARIA that allow us to do similar things, right, that have semantic meaning. So one is ARIA selected and ARIA expanded. And then we have ARIA hidden. So those allow us to manage state. You can just hook into those with JavaScript. It'll open and close things and change that. And then when you change that, that alerts the screen reader so they know what's going on. So they can tab through and interact with your JavaScript-controlled module and get feedback around what they're doing. So that's one way to make this successful. So if I was writing the Sass for that, it's a little bit more verbose, a little more to it, right? Because we have more hooks that we need to adjust and toggle. So you end up with something kind of like that. So we have a selected state. So when I'm tabbing through, there's some type of visual cue that I've actually tabbed into the title. And then there's is it selected or expanded or not, right? So that's there. Okay, so any questions so far about BIM or modules or Sass that you're just dying to know that I could answer? All right, let's go into some real examples and kind of show you what's going on. All righty. Let me do this. There we go. We'll give you that, and we'll give you this. Yeah. Okay. So this is a pattern library. Who's built a pattern library before? They're glorious. I love them so much. They're so much fun to work with. We do this now for pretty much every client. It's a good handoff for them so they can maintain and manage what we've set up for them before. So a pattern library is basically just a whole bunch of components kind of like stuck together in some UI so they can see what you've built. So in this one, we have like basic headings that show like what an H1, H6 should look like, what the HTML looks like, some variations of that. We have some hooks following like O, CSS. We have something that should look like an H1, but semantically it shouldn't be an H1. So classes to give them hooks that way. And that's all in base, right? So there are a few things in base, like a grid system, so they can do what they need to do. But again, most of the magic happens down here in modules. So we've created a handful of modules for them. Here's an accordion. Imagine that. More accordions. So what we do for most of our clients, because we're typically interfacing with front-end teams that may be a little bit anemic, may not be super specialized in what they do. They may be backend developers, Java, .NET, Ruby in some cases. They don't quite grok the front end as well as somebody that specializes in front end work. So we try and give them a bit more explanation around why to use a pattern and how to use it so they kind of know they don't make silly mistakes that some of them make sometimes. So we define what the accordion is, typically how we're going to use it, where we're going to use it at, and then we define how they're actually going to use that and set up in the HTML. So a typical accordion has a wrapper and an action and a panel, what we're doing to manage state, and then for JavaScript. Now in this case, we're not doing too much ARIA work. It's an internal app. There's only like a couple thousand folks that use it. And as far as we know, there's nobody using a screen reader using application because it just totally wouldn't work at all. This was for a real estate brokerage company. So lots and lots and lots of forms, a little bit painful. So you get a live example, right? That shows functionally how things should look, how things should look and how things should work. And then we give them an HTML example. I really enjoy using definition lists or description lists, whatever you want to call those. They're really great for key value pair type things. And then we're just managing state with a data attribute in this case. So you have accordions. We did a custom module we called the page push module that looks kind of like that. There's a progress bar that they can use, showing them the various states so they know what's going on. Again, this is just an ordered list with some classes. We have alerts, right, that do their thing, that show the various states, so a message, a warning, an error, success. Define some JavaScript that they might want to use, so we wrote a bunch of custom JavaScript for them. This one is just you click on the X and it goes away. We have buttons. Now in this case, right, we have a primary button, and this is a .NET app, so buttons needed to work and be the same across buttons, links, inputs, and we gave them a small alternative, so it's a little bit more tiny. There's a secondary button, does the same thing. And then this is the case where we're taking a module, or a couple modules, and combining them into a third module called a button group. This is their typical button pattern, where we have our primary actions, which are here on the right, and our secondary actions, that's here on the left. So they can add as many buttons as they want, and things will lay out appropriately. And then we have things like this, right? So this is taking all of these patterns and combining a handful into one, one page to build a page. So we have our page push here at the top. We have our progress bar here. We have all the various form things that we did. We actually built them a fairly robust form grid system. So you can toggle a class, it's either horizontal or vertical, and it'll lay things out accordingly. Like in this case, we have horizontal with vertical labels, but then some other stuff in here that's horizontal, tables and all that jazz. So the power of this approach, right? What makes this work really well is that you've built this core set of components that as a team, you can maintain on a modular level. So if you have 20 folks working in the same code base, you're not constantly squishing each other's code and dealing with merge errors if using verge control. To create this page took like half an hour, right? So we have a rapidly prototyped page, took a half an hour of work with production level code, which is pretty good, right? So we can create things on the fly fairly quickly, test out UI flows, test out data, get that in front of users, get feedback, and make some adjustments just on the front end before this goes to being committed to the code base, which is really nice. Now the code for this, which is useful, again, I tend to like smacks a good bit. So we have source here. Ignore all this other stuff because we don't care about it for the most part. We have an assets folder, and then within that we have style sheets. So we have base. Now, I'm kind of lazy when it comes to using base type stuff. So these are all of the base level elements that would exist. Code, emphasis, fonts, font family, our grid, which is there, headings, any HTML5 type elements that exist. This is really just a version of normalize that we just kind of create for every app, and then we modify it specifically so it's specific to the app that we're doing, so we're not overriding things. We have base there. Because we're using Sass, we have helpers, and we have some setup stuff, so things like functions, mix-ins, utilities that we might use. Now, all of the magic Like, it really happens here in our modules. So we look at the accordion, right? Here's the CSS. Now, with the exception of my poorly written mix-in, it's probably like a couple years old now, there's a color here, but everything that you see here is strictly structure. There's no look and feel. It's just laying the accordion out like it should be laid out. Now, if we scroll down and go to our themes folder, we have a blue theme, which is the cardinal theme that we're using. I can click on the theme version of the CSS. That's what I get. So it's just the classes and look and feel that I need that's specific to the cardinal theme. Now, if you're getting super fancy, and we're trying to figure out the best way to do this, is I could go create a new theme, the Iron Yard. Let's do the Iron Yard. We're going to theme this to look like the Iron Yard. So I could do a theme the Iron Yard. And it basically takes my theme folder for blue, copies that with blank values for my colors, right? Or if you're getting super fancy in Sass, you can abstract those out into variables. And all you have to do is change a handful of variable colors, and then it changes your look and feel for the Iron Yards, which is like grays and some other cool colors, right? So all of our modules are set up that way. So there's a one-to-one correlation between our modules that are structural and our modules that are theme-based. And then, let's see, here we go. So in this case, we have theme-specific variables that we're putting in for our heading sizes, like our font family. We're doing some funky stuff with colors, but we're using colors here, and we reset all those. So technically, all of your colors should be stored in variables. So whenever you're creating a new theme, you just change your variables for that specific theme, and it just kind of magically works. As long as you're not like if you have 10 colors, it's probably going to be kind of dicey. But in most cases, you have 2, 3, maybe 4 core colors that you use. And that's what we set up. So we do that for every single module. In this case, we're setting up some examples that we can use. And again, I'm using Slim because I'm lazy, and it's nice and terse. So I'm writing HTML without writing a bunch of brackets and odds and ends. It looks like Sass if you use the Sass syntax, which makes me super happy. So we're just using that. We just create these modules on the fly, dump those in, copy and paste from the pattern library, and we can create pages fairly quickly. So that's what we have. That's kind of how it works. So closing thoughts. Oh, well, you can find this online. It's built in Middleman. So if you dig static site generators, Middleman's kind of my personal favorite. It allows you to write Ruby type code without actually having to write a bunch of Ruby type code. And you can spit out a bunch of static sites fairly quickly. I use it for all my conference sites. So it's great. It's fast. All the code and examples are there. You can steal or borrow or tinker with whatever you find useful. And then the most important thing, I think, is there's just so much out there, and things change so much. I mean, there's Sass, there's Less, there's Stylus. Anybody use Stylus out of curiosity? I love Stylus, again, because I'm lazy, and it's super terse. And I don't have to write brackets or semicolons or colons or any of that nonsense. I can just like type stuff, and it just knows what to do and makes it work, which is great, because I suck at typing anyway, because I'm from Alabama. But with all these things, Less and Stylus and Sass, they're all great technologies. There's preprocessors, there's post-processors. Just don't be dogmatic, right? Just find what you like, enjoy using it. And Chris Courier is kind of my personal hero. He's great. Runs CSS Tricks, if you read CSS Tricks. He's the creator of CodePen. If you use CodePen for your code examples, the nicest person I think you'll ever meet. And this is kind of his mantra, is like just try, pick something, do a good job, enjoy doing it, or don't enjoy, like struggle doing whatever you're trying to do sometimes, because that's how coding works. But just do it, do a good job. And that's really all you should expect of yourself. Because there's no reason to be like super dogmatic about, like, I love Sass, and Sass is the only thing that anybody should ever use because it's the best. I think Chris Epstein, one of the curators of Sass, called those people Sassholes, which is a pretty good naming, right? Like, don't be like that. because we're all just building things on the front end and trying to make stuff. So just be like Chris. Just try and do a good job. That's all I have.